Legendary Godoy here. This video will serve as a pretty much a catalyst for any Killer Instinct character I use here on this channel, and I'm actually happy I get to show how powerful these characters naturally are. This will also help you guys understand why I made Hulk versus Sabrewolf the way I did, because these characters are extremely powerful and definitely underrated. So we'll be using a composite verse for Killer Instinct games and pretty much all games, even the comics here. So let's begin here, and we'll start off with the simple category of strength. Now, many characters in Killer Instinct actually scale to the likes of Gargos and Agnos. Agnos is actually one of the ridiculously stronger characters in the Killer Instinct game. He's definitely the big brute of the entire bunch here, and he actually does scale to Gargos in attack potency and in just flat-out strength and power. So, what is Agnos capable of doing? Well, Agnos is actually capable of drawing upon the astral plane. He actually is able to draw this wide variety of energy, which allows him to increase his physical strength here. And this allows him to beat a plethora of characters in the game from, you know, from the lowest, you know, jobbers like, Fjolgor is definitely a jobber. He's been able to beat Fjolgor plenty of times. To the likes of Gargos, he's actually stalemated Gargos on multiple occasions. So, you know, if you guys want to pause the video and look at this part here, it does indicate that Agnos is actually capable of drawing upon the astral energies of the astral plane. Now, the astral plane is, I wouldn't say it's hard to describe here, but it looks so unique here. I have to say it would definitely be the universe itself, because you can actually see stars, galaxies, and pretty much that's it here. You have this little wormhole, as you can see here, and this platform. Now, characters in Killer Instinct also scale to the likes of, you know, Gargos. Gargos is actually one of the Shao Kahn, the Jeddah Doma, the Dark Side, the Thanos of the entire joint here. And actually, he scales roughly above everybody in here, including the likes of Jago, a character that can also bend the astral energies to his will. They was able to make a tiger spirit out of it, and was actually able to influence Jago with the astral energy, even bend it to his will. So Gargos is actually from the very beginning was a planetary threat. He would actually go around conquering worlds, like multiple worlds, including Earth. This means, again, that there is a multiverse out there for the Killer Instinct characters as well. There's a multiverse. So Gargos, again, you could say this is a multiversal threat, like Shao Kahn here. He's able to go around and actually conquer multiple worlds. He actually does this with, again, his army like any other conqueror. He has characters like Omen, who he actually made out of the astral plane itself and made them out of the astral energies. So these characters would definitely be around high level. These guys are around high level beings, as they are pretty much astral, you know, astral beings in in general, right? So, Gargos being able to destroy planets and conquer them if he so chooses. He also, again, scales above roughly every other combatant in the game, alright? He even scales above Idol, who can actually pull things through the fabric of space and time. Even his defeat, you know, by the hands of Orchid or pretty much any character in the game, actually causes a shift that tears a hole through space and time, even being able to rip the Ultra Tech's tower back through it. So again, time and space are actually being torn apart by these characters, and you can definitely say Saberwolf, Jago, Sadira, Orchid are definitely on characters this kind of caliber, as they're able to defeat characters that can rip space and time apart and manipulate time casually. In terms of speed, they would scale to Glacius. Now, why is that? Well, Glacius in travel speed is actually able to move in milliseconds. That's, again, definitely faster than light here. Or you could say, I think it's about the same as a human eye blink. We blink in, like, milliseconds. Or at least somewhere around that area. So, again, you have characters that scale to Glacius, but it's actually his attacking or combat speed that's really needed, focused on here. He can actually freeze someone in 0.026 seconds. If you actually look at that or look it up, that's actually in nanoseconds, okay? So, characters in Killer Instinct like Cinder, Fulgor, Saberwolf, Gargos, Agonos, Kanra, TJ Combo. These guys being able to keep up, and yeah, some of them do lose here, but the only one that's actually been able to get a rematch and beat him was Saberwolf, and, you know, Cinder actually lost to him plenty of times, but Cinder is a very powerful character in his own right here. So, again, these characters are capable of hanging with someone that moves in nanoseconds. That would definitely put them around the nanosecond area, and if you want to say they beat him in combat, that will put them higher into the realm of, I believe it's picoseconds. If it's that's above nanoseconds, I do believe picoseconds are up next here. So yeah, and you're probably going to see here, actually you see right now, this is about Gargos. So back to Gargos, right? Well, in terms of power, right? Gargos is actually so powerful that he actually needs demigods and astral beings to actually beat him. This is from multiple realms, multiple armies from different pantheons, okay? So it took multiple demigods, gods, and astral beings, right? Or, you know, gods are pretty much astral beings, so what am I talking about? So basically, these would be entire pantheons. As you have your demigods, like Hercules, right? For an example, you have, like, Hercules, Perseus, I think that's the only Sons of Zeus I actually know, right? Then you have your astral beings like, Zeus, Hera, Apollo, Hermes, Poseidon, Hades, okay? You have all those guys being able to fight against Gargos, all right? And so it took multiple of these pantheons. So you have, like, multiple Zeuses, multiple Perseus, multiple Hercules. You have characters of that caliber. And they're all trying to, you know, they were able to beat Gargos, and they weren't only just able to beat him, they had to seal him away so that he wouldn't come back. So yeah, I actually think that's pretty impressive in my opinion, that Gargos is actually, you know, required entire pantheons to beat, you know, multiple pantheons, not just one. So you would have like the Greek pantheon, the Egyptian pantheon, and the Norse pantheon. Now, I'm using these as examples, remember? Okay? These are just simply examples here. I'm trying to just, you know, give you guys a picture. So it took multiple pantheons, right? So let's say Gargos was, you know, on Earth thousands of years ago. You have the Greek pantheon, the Egyptian pantheon, and the Norse pantheon. You can even add the Chinese or, you know, the Asian pantheon in there as well. So these characters are, you know, going ham on Gargos. It takes multiple pantheons to just, you know, throw Gargos back to where he came from and sealed an entire astral plane, an entire universe. And yet Gargos couple years later, after he's mastered the astral plane completely, is able to rip through it and come along. Now let's talk about Hack's resistance here. Again, these guys will have, you know, resistance to time manipulation, as they've been able to, you know, defeat Idol on multiple occasions. These characters will be also able to defeat Hisako, which is a ghost, which means these guys also nake intangibility and, you know, invisibility as well, as they're being able to see a ghost as well. So yeah, I gotta say here that that's not gonna help them either. They also nake intangibility, which is actually a big, you know, a big deal when you consider the fact that you need to be intangible or on a ghost level to even, you know, harm someone like that. So again, I don't really think that matters here. I don't really think that matters, in my opinion. I really don't think it would matter in combat if you turn intangible or if you're just naturally intangible. These characters are able to neg that and, you know, they pretty much just nullify that completely. So, I think that's pretty much it here for Killer Instinct here, you guys, you know. But I'm actually doing a new thing as the year 2021 comes around. I've made it. We survived it. But I'm actually going to do something new. We're going to be doing comparisons here. Now, in terms of... Now, comparisons are when I compare them to, like, other characters from other universes. Like Marvel, DC, Capcom, you know, Transformers, Godzilla, Justice League, Avengers, Legion of Doom. You guys get it, right? Okay, so in terms of skill here, these guys are expert level hand-to-hand combatants. They actually are able to master their own fighting styles here. They would definitely be on par with characters like White Tiger and Bronze Tiger. I actually think these characters will be on that caliber. These guys, in terms of physical strength, I definitely have to say they're definitely on par with some of Marvel's greatest, you know, characters they've created. The likes of Thor, Colossus, Gladiator, Hyperion, Vision, Wonder Man. You can even add the likes of Hulk, Black Bolt, and Hercules on there as well. All right, these characters are definitely that strong. These guys are able to battle against someone who can pretty much take on entire pantheons, probably multiple astral beings. Beings that exist on pretty much higher planes than our own. If you guys want the DC perspective, okay, yeah, you have characters like Superman, Martian Manhunter. Ooh. Sorry, my nose there. You have characters like Superman, Martian Manhunter, Wonder Woman, Cyborg, Starfire, Donna Troy, Tempest, all right? Even you can compare them to Shazam and Black Adam, all right? Now, I wouldn't say they'd be more on... they'd definitely be able to give them a good run for their money, but definitely not be able to beat them at least all the time. I definitely say it's a 5 out of 10 each way here. And then you have characters like them from Mortal Kombat, all right? You have characters like Scorpion and Sub-Zero. You can even add characters like Grimlock, Monster X, and Godzilla, all right? Optimus Prime, Megatron, Jedidoma, all right? They would definitely be able to give these kinds of characters a run for their money. Sorry, hold on. Give me a second here. These guys would definitely be able to give these kind of characters a run for their money. For example, if the Glacius goes up against Gladiator, Glacius has a very fair chance of coming out on top here. His ice, you know, his freezing ability is well beyond the molecular level. He can freeze someone down to the molecular level, even freeze souls, okay? Because, you know, he can kill Hisako, all right? Game mechanics. These game mechanics are overpowered. I mean, honestly, it's just... It is what it is, all right? Game mechanics are just hella overpowered. That's like saying, you know, okay, so your character in the game was able to beat Diablos. Now he can beat every Diablos the same way. Yeah, that's pretty much how it would work. You know, you can beat every Diablos. You can beat every Rathalos. You can even beat every Odagarin the same way. All right? I mean, seriously here, you guys. These Killer Instinct characters are no joke. And I've thought about debunking Death Battle a couple times, maybe, about, you know, Glacius versus Sub-Zero and Sabrewolf versus John Talbain. But I'm actually going to leave those matches out the table. So you guys, these Killer Instinct characters are extremely overpowered. Also, get ready for the Monster Colosseum, which starts its first round today. This is Legendary Ghidorah, and I will see you guys later. Peace.